display and speak about them. Mom traveled thousands of miles while guiding and giving opportunities to her children and embedded life lessons. No obstacle to excellence was too big for my mother's vivacious spirit to seek ways to overcome. She found the best opportunities for each of her children and selflessly helped them to access those opportunities. Whether driving from Chicago to Rockton for ice skating or from Rockford to Chicago for gymnastics lessons. Mom's vision and spirit set another kind of example, which taught me to treat my competitors with dignity and respect. Mom loved people. Thinking deeply appealed to her search for highest virtues. A glimpse of my mother's visionary thoughts and virtuous priorities can be seen during an unusual meeting and conversation. I had turned professional and had been contracted to do commercials for Kodak Camera Company. My career had a positive trajectory. I was at that time the highest paid female athlete in the world. Mom was in a limousine for the first and I think only time in New York with Kodak executives. One of them asked my mother, "What hopes and dreams do you have for Janet?" My mother answered simply, "To have a good family someday."
Hello.
My talented mother made her home and garden lovely and welcoming to anyone. She sketched out her terraced gardens in detail and did much of the gardening work. I've framed her sketches. Mom made neighbors, friends, those in need, and many corporate as well as international guests feel comfortable at our family home. She assisted the elderly in Rockford for years after her children were grown. At age 74, she took painting classes so she could beautifully paint the birds that came to her garden sanctuary. When traveling in the US as well as overseas, my mother navigated with grace, dignity, and wisdom in unknown and highly unpredictable situations. In all places, her joy, smile, and laughter were contagious. I could speak much more on how my mother had vision, acted with self-discipline, applied individual thought, set her priorities, practiced with repetition to improve with unassuming humility, persevered and endured all things while exhibiting a joyful exuberance. A child of the Great Depression and World War II, my dynamic mother believed every good thing was within reach due to American liberty crafted for individual vision, faith, self-discipline, and hard work. Having seen its godless antithesis on the other side of the world, she cherished American liberty under God. My father and mother coalesced on how to raise their children. They believed in developing the whole child spiritually, mentally, and physically. They strove to provide high moral standards. They envisioned excellence of skill and honorable character. I now express their vision for child rearing and family life as seeking the excellence of truth, goodness, and beauty. My parents did not often lecture. With every fiber of their being, though imperfect, they lived and implemented the goodness they believed in, and in that process applied to daily life the 8 tools of excellence. Their vision, hard work, and priorities provided tremendous opportunities, lessons, and joys for life. Context accentuates my parents' well-founded vision for child rearing that took form within the shifting cultural backdrop in which so-called child experts declared discipline bad for children. As my parents began developing their family in the 1960s generation was a few years away on the horizon, which was looming with dark, turbulent clouds. During the 1960s and 1970s, masses of people, various ages, but predominantly younger people who called themselves hippies, exhibited by choice a lack of self-discipline. This included casual use of mind-altering drugs, including one labeled weed. In addition, the illusion of free love insisted upon fracturing the existing order of responsible love. These renegades advanced the mantra, love and peace, while belittling, deconstructing, and discarding hard-won foundations of lasting, practical love and peace. These estranged ideas and actions began to slowly uproot and discard the civil order of American society. To add perspective, a distinct, contrasting historical example reaches back to good lasting seeds planted in American soil. We read the same words, love and peace, in a first-hand account titled Mort's Relation, a Journal of the Pilgrims at Plymouth. The original text is cited as written in the year 1622. Love and peace were offered through those exact words and specific intent by Pilgrim Edward Winslow on behalf of King James of England to the great Indian King Massasoit. This encounter led to goodwill and peace between the Pilgrims and Massasoit's people. A footnote in Mort's Relation reads, quote, "This first American mutual security pact remained inviolate throughout Massasoit's life," end quote. Thus, excellent ideas of lasting, practical love and peace were planted early and firmly in American soil. Changing centuries again, masses in the 1960s generation recklessly did everything in their power to pull up and destroy the good seed planted in America. Historic love and peace, which had been brought about by extraordinary leadership and ideas near Plymouth in the 1600s, was upended by 20th century undisciplined, utopian, collective thinking people. They thought they could improve upon American culture and functions by deconstructing and redefining historically validated love and peace. These renegades also took it upon themselves to redefine freedom and liberty to mean license. Their brazen and garish cry for liberty without limits rang out loudly with these easy-sounding words while I was growing up: if it feels good, do it. It is within this darkened cultural deconstruction my parents made their own individual decisions about child rearing and continued to plant historic good seeds along their way. It was the age in which I was raised, trained, and had to make my own determinations of conscience. It was in these surroundings that I slowly grasped concepts and appreciation through conveyors and tools of excellence of the sublime joys that result from self-discipline and internal order. This internal order leads to self-government. We will temporarily discuss self-government. James Madison is known as the chief architect of the U.S. Constitution. He exhibited the 8 tools of excellence. I learned from an archivist at James Madison's Montpelier that in the upstairs library of his home, Madison read and studied on his own initiative 400 books in 7 languages to study and take copious notes on all the confederacies in the history of the world. He did this independently to learn how man can best govern himself. Ideas of self-government and what has been called ordered liberty in America were searched for and finally crafted. Liberty was codified in the US Constitution. Liberty then increased for all Americans over centuries. This long and costly advance and ascendancy of human freedom has never been known before in human history. Primary foundations of liberty include Judeo-Christian principles and natural law. We read in the Declaration of Independence that pillars of American liberty are rested upon the laws of nature and nature's God. The founders of the American Constitutional Republic understood human nature. They wrote with clarity that behavior, at the least, aligning with Judeo-Christian principles in moral, self-governed, and religious individuals, is required to preserve liberty and order in America. The following is a quotation attributed to James Madison in 1778. Quote, "We have staked the whole future of American civilization not upon the power of government, far from it. We have staked the future of all our political institutions upon the capacity of mankind for self-government, upon the capacity of each and all of us to govern ourselves, to control ourselves, to sustain ourselves, according to the 10 commandments of God." End quote. Madison argued that an individual's thoughts, duties, and decisions relating to his or her creator should be, quote, "directed only by reason and conviction, not by force or violence," end quote. Decisions are destiny. Returning our thoughts again to the mid-20th century, the hippie free love movement, also dubbed the Age of Aquarius, rang out mystical musical lyrics emotionally declaring, "Let the sun shine in." These same perpetrators sought to eliminate the maker of the sun, fracturing the brilliant light of liberty from its source. The 1960s was an unpeaceful, chaotic, dark era in which many ugly weeds were purposely planted and a storm of ideas foreign to liberty rocked, pelted, and tore at the ship of state, America. It is much easier to destroy than to build. This troubled movement of the 1960s introduced and promoted mockery of protective, healthy, and steadying ideas and disciplines. Yet, steadying the ship of state and individual Americans against wild weeds blowing in the wind and destructive stormy seas were evaluated, validated, sound ideas, and conveyors and tools of excellence. Many, including me, had the opportunities to thrive as common pebbles, polished by diamond dust in individuals employing the excellent American mind and spirit, and within reach of 1,000 flashes of reflected light. Acquiring self-discipline leading to self-government was paramount to my parents' vision and goals. Athletics was a healthy method to achieve this vision. This vision led to my first meeting with Miss Slavka Kahoot, whom my parents saw teaching with a sense of discipline at the Wagon Wheel Ice Palace in Rockton, Illinois, during a family weekend. We were visiting to explore the Wagon Wheel and Ice Palace for the first time. I was 5 years old on this weekend when my parents asked me if I wanted to take a lesson from the skating teacher whom I saw on the ice at the Ice Palace. With my always present shyness, I quietly replied, yes. They then asked Miss Cahoot if she would give me a lesson. She responded, would you let me? Slavka recalls this as the beginning of a match made in heaven. I loved Miss Cahoot. Now for a long time, I barely said anything to her. I just listened, learned, and did what she asked. What is discipline that leads to healthy self-discipline? Excerpts from Noah Webster's American Dictionary define discipline as, quote, to instruct or educate, to inform the mind, to prepare by instruction and correct principles and habits, as to discipline youth for a profession or for future usefulness, to teach rules and practice, to advance and prepare by instruction, end quote. Profound physical, mental, and spiritual lessons and habits formed through the kind of discipline I just defined were only beginning for me as I entered a student-teacher relationship with Ms. Slavka Cahoot at age 5. Of course, I was unaware that at that time I was embarking upon lessons in self-government and glorious liberty, aligning mentally and physically on ice with the laws of nature and nature's God. I had to align mentally and physically on ice with the laws of nature and nature's God. Slavka Cahoot had to stop amateur skating and competitions at age 16 due to the loss of her father. She had skated for about 13 years within a logical developmental system of figure skating that required certain tests of training to advance. Her parents provided opportunities for her to spend time training with a couple of the best figure skating instructors in North America. She excelled and competed at the national level with the best. Her parents' talents and understandings of art and beauty were obviously passed on to Slavka. She once told me her World War I veteran father was a founder of FTD Florists, and her mother's artwork had been displayed at a prestigious art museum in Chicago. Along her way, the genius of Slavka Cahoot, of which I was one of many beneficiaries, took form and flourished. At age 9, Slavka was offered the opportunity by her parents to attend the renowned Interlochen Music Camp in Northern Michigan. She studied ballet at the camp. At such a tender age, 9, she decided by her own free will and initiative in her spare time to attend and study the orchestra rehearsals, not the performances. She was fascinated with how the orchestra worked toward excellence of sound. This was accomplished by practicing and improving each small section of the music apart from the other sections. Repetitive work concentrated on improving technique and skill until the result was coherent and cohesive, orderly sound and beauty. Then the improved sections would all be played together again. This is how and when, at age 9, she learned to integrate this method of practice and improvement and apply it to skating, and later to teach figure skating. It was how she taught me. In this one exercise of Slavka's own choosing at age 9, to study orchestra rehearsals, she exhibited all 8 functional attributes and disciplines of pursuing excellence: vision, action, logical individual thought, priorities, practice and repetition, humility, perseverance and endurance, and joy. Joy, like an internal flash of light illuminating satisfaction as one succeeds in small steps for self-improvement and accomplishment. These flashes of light provide human dignity and inspiration for the pathway and to overcome the obstacles toward excellence. Jewels with a destiny appear first as ordinary pebbles, yet when crafted and polished, carry thousands of shining flashes of reflected light. Slavka, which means glory, taught figure skating to put herself through college, earning a degree in biology with a plan to become a physician. Instead, she beneficently helped her sibling through school by working, and she became my beloved teacher and mentor. She introduced me to the excellence of truth, goodness, and beauty in figure skating thought and movement. Slavka has told me that she understood how the body moves. She integrated her knowledge of the human mind and body with her knowledge of figure skating. She introduced me both to meandering and systematic methods to bring my disordered, untrained mind and body into self-disciplined, orderly thought with consistent, beautiful movement. I accentuate, excellence is advanced in liberty when self-discipline or self-government succeeds in transforming disorder into order. I will repeat that. Excellence is advanced in liberty when self-discipline or self-government succeeds in transforming disorder into order. The details of how these beautiful functions in ICE were formed will not be discussed today. I will only sketch out a few instances which I now realize embedded life lessons as I was slowly introduced to functions and attributes of excellence. First are the excellent priorities and philosophy Ms. Cahoot set as her template and plumb line as a teacher and mentor. A basic philosophy for skating, teaching skating, which I saw her exhibit and teach, included, skating had to be fun. The pursuit of excellence day by day required hard, intelligent work. Personal improvement of each movement and skill was the goal. I will repeat that because it was the only goal. Personal improvement of each movement and skill was the goal. I was never told or asked to win by either my coach or my parents. Ms. Cahoot and my parents only asked that I set goals, work hard, have fun, behave well, and do my best. Ms. Cahoot never asked me to do something my mind and body were not prepared to do. When I was prepared mentally and physically, she would offer coaching inspiration and impetus for me to try to push myself beyond what I thought I could do. My coach never, ever, ever criticized any public performance I gave. She only took mental notes of what she needed to work on with me for the next time. An example of the result for me of these priorities and philosophy can be found on a Saturday when I had skated about 7 hours already and had an afternoon lesson. Ms. Cahoot told me after my lesson I had skated enough. It was time to get off the ice and go home. She went on to concentrate on other lessons. More than an hour later, she realized I was still on the ice, just playing, joyfully, trying and practicing different skills. I love to skate. Having fun under Ms. Cahoot's tutelage during 6 years of consistent figure skating, I became the U.S. Ladies Junior National Champion at age 12. Separately, in the spiritual realm, under the guidance of our family pastor, That was the year, by logical reasoning and personal faith at a church camp, I invited Jesus Christ to lead my life and my skating. He is the source of a perfect template and plumb line of excellence. After I won the junior national title, if not for the generosity and support of Mr. Walter Williamson, founder and builder of the Wagon Wheel and Ice Palace where I skated, I would have had to stop skating at age 12. As I now understand it, he offered my parents free ice time for me. I wrote about Mr. Williamson and his beautiful resort in my book entitled The Wheel, Legacy of Excellence. It is available here at Midway Village Museum and at the Rockton Township Historical Society in Rockton, Illinois. Instead of ending my skating at age 12, a month after winning the junior national title, I was on my way to Davos, Switzerland with Miss Cahoot to train and compete in Europe. This was my first time in Europe. The trip took me, for the first time, away from my family for an extended time. As I sat and observed on the train, it was making its way through the majestic snow-covered Swiss Alps toward Davos. Miss Cahoot enthusiastically, with light flashing from her eyes, asked me, "Janet, what are you thinking?" I answered, "Nothing." It is probably the last time I was thinking nothing. It is only one incident in which Miss Cahoot taught me by asking me questions. After all, to pursue and appreciate excellence, much inquiry is required. At age 13, I placed fourth in the Senior Ladies Nationals, which made me the alternate to the US World Ladies Figure Skating Team. In this position, Miss Cahoot took me to Vienna, Austria, to observe a World Championships for the first time. Distinct introductions to excellence occurred in Vienna. I had the enviable opportunity to observe the best figure skaters in the world while sitting next to my new friend and 13-year-old peer, Mary. She was the daughter of famed ABC Wide World of Sports commentator Jim McKay, known by his colleagues as the Wordsmith. We were only children, but my mind's eye and spirit were uplifted and expanded to an expectation toward higher thoughts, skill, and maturity. The most memorable skating excellence in Vienna was that of Ludmila Belousova and Oleg Protopopov, also known as the Protopopovs, the Soviet pair champions. Their performance was the first time I saw anyone from the communist country of the Soviet Union or heard of that nation. I observed their beauty and pursuit of excellence as they competed and won with elegance in baby blue costumes in gray rain on outdoor ice. Their figure skating exhibited the pursuit of truth, goodness, and beauty, rising under great duress. Their courage is astounding and inspiring. Over a decade later, I became artistic-minded friends with Oleg and Ludmila. After their pursuit of truth, goodness, and beauty in their art led to their courageous and very dangerous defection from the USSR. I now know they lived, trained, and performed under severe state control and oppression due to living in a socialist communist nation. As a free American, I would thankfully never know or be forced to live within this kind of heavy-handed, ugly state control. During the 1967 World Championships, I received a special invitation to enter and observe inside the ABC Wide World of Sports truck as it filmed and transmitted skating images and commentary across the ocean. the ABC Wide World of Sports entity and its visionary leaders conveyed excellence in sports broadcasting. I heard and saw excellence in another realm. Without the availability of internet or cell phones, Ms. Cahoot planned a day of excursions in Vienna for fun. She took me to the famed Soccer Hotel to have tea and to taste the equally famed soccer torte. I tasted and smelled aromas of excellence. She took me to the Loden Factory, a famed garment store that produces and makes clothing out of finest wool and fabrics. I felt excellence. She took me to the renowned Spanish riding school to see the exquisite Lipizzaner horses perform to music. We stood among throngs of people. I was little and kind of looking like this to watch. In another discipline, I heard and observed excellence. Ms. Cahoot, I learned, I was invited to perform in Vienna, along with the best in the world, in an exhibition to take place the day after the World Championships. I had not practiced since arriving in Vienna. My coach, in some unknown way, arranged for me to practice at an ice arena that had an exciting, historic, and storied figure skating past and was about to be closed forever. On this dreary, dark evening, an elderly man, who was once a great figure skating champion, opened the heavy wooden door of the arena. We were the only ones there to skate. Though it was dark, cold, pouring rain on the outdoor ice rink, I could not help but absorb Ms. Cahoot's vibrant excitement, resounding in her voice as she told me more than once, "It is such an honor to be hosted by this famous figure skating champion and to skate in this historic ice arena." Mm-hmm. She led me in the pouring rain on outdoor ice with a few lights on through a simple practice as her eyes sparkled and reflected their light into me and the surroundings, as if reflecting off the raindrops. I saw, felt, heard, and knew my coach Slavka Cahoot's excellence of spirit. Functional attributes and disciplines are required to produce a heart of excellence which flashes light into the world. In such healthy circumstances, at age 12, I had dared to even think of an unspoken goal to make the Olympic team someday. Concurrently, Ms. Cahoot expertly managed the Wagon Wheel Ice Palace and was in the process of developing one of the finest figure skating schools in the world at the Wagon Wheel. Ms. Cahoot built a refined school of figure skating through her individual vision, action, logical individual thought, priorities, practice and repetition, humility, perseverance and endurance, and joy. I was 14 in the 1968 Olympic year. Like all other years, Ms. Cahoot chose music to choreograph the program she planned for me to use in all competitions for the year. For the 1968 competition season, she brilliantly chose to begin my music, my program, with the music Afternoon of a Faun by Claude Debussy. Other beautiful and expressive musical pieces were cohesively and artistically integrated into the whole program. Choosing and cutting musical pieces together with coherence, cohesiveness, precision, and beauty of sound were only one part of Ms. Cahoot's genius. The day to begin choreography arrived. Ms. Cahoot played the music with me on the ice. We both began moving to the music independently. She explained that music and movement can be expressed in questions and answers. She listened carefully to the music while applying the movements and language that are figure skating to each note and melody of the music. She watched me move. She thought. She continued moving on the ice, intuitively, creatively, intellectually. The music physically moved her. She exhibited to me how beautiful music can fill the mind, body, soul, and spirit in a way that musical language instructs the language of pure movement on ice, pure joy. My teacher chose movements precisely to the music that she explained were the questions. She then integrated answers in the music with answers in figure skating language and movements. Ms. Cahoot began gently teaching me to think, move, and move in questions and answers and in metaphors with artistry. She was confident as she beautifully redefined for me Afternoon of a Faun, F-A-U-N. She asked me to think about trying to imitate a young deer, a fawn, F-A-W-N, running through the forest, happily jumping over logs and streams, and alighting in sun-drenched flowery meadows. The first movement was to bend down and reach toward the ice, and then lift my arms, gently reaching outward. She asked me to consider I was tenderly picking up beautiful flowers and joyfully releasing them into the air. Perhaps she envisioned flowers her father had arranged and delivered, or that her mother had painted. Ironically, after I surprised everyone, including myself, by winning a place as the youngest athlete on the 1968 US Olympic team at age 14, figure skating officials tried to pressure Ms. Cahoot into changing my music and program in just a two-week front time frame. They said Afternoon of a Faun was too mature and avant-garde for me. Ms. Cahoot politely ignored them. They did not understand her genius or her artistry born of truth, goodness, and beauty. They did not understand her investment in vision and all the tools of excellence, or that she had taught me to think in metaphors to redefine Faun, F-A-U-N, to Faun, F-A-W-N. Afternoon of a Faun became a signature piece of music for performances I gave all the way near to the end of my professional career in 1982. In 1970, I had warmed up for the final performance to defend my US ladies' national title for the first time. I was 16. I was in first place after the school figures, which were the circle eights that we did, all different kinds, over 60 different kinds. After the 3-minute figure skating warm-up, Ms. Cahoot often found a quiet place so we could be alone while I awaited my turn to skate. On this occasion, she found an empty ladies' room with mirrors. She simply asked me to do arm movements in front of the mirror. She told me my arm movements were beautiful, and I was beautiful. She then, with her eyes sparkling into mine, told me, "Come on, tell a story." I won the second of 5 US Ladies Championships that night. Those excellent words, "go out and tell a story," have led me metaphorically in skating and in life. Ms. Cahoot's genius, alongside the beautiful and logical developmental figure skating system that then existed, which no longer exists, taught me a complete language and dictionary of figure skating. She taught me how the body moves and then how to think and move with precision in questions and answers and in metaphors. I once had a 3.5-hour lesson to improve with finesse one simple term. Step by step, she taught me self-government. The more I developed self-government on ice, aligning my mind and movements with the laws of nature and nature's God, the more I enjoyed glorious freedom on ice. I was free to do anything within the laws of nature and nature's God. My beloved coach's excellence in priorities and philosophy appeared through a question she waited 40 years to ask me. In Bratislava, Czechoslovakia, at the World Championships in 1973, I fell twice in a minute and 20 seconds on a jump that had always been my favorite and best. When I got off the ice, and for the following 40 years, Miss Cahoon never, ever mentioned or asked me about this performance. I mentioned already that she never asked me to win. She never criticized my public performances. She regularly taught me to skate and taught me to think by asking me questions. When I was an adult, 40 years after Bratislava, Slavka quietly asked me, with her eyes sparkling into mine, "Janet, what happened in Bratislava?" In the same fashion she had taught me, if she asked me a question, I went searching for an answer. I spent nearly 3 years, as I had time, thinking, evaluating cause and effect, and asking myself questions to find a logical answer. I also wanted to know the answer. I finally arrived at my analysis and conclusion, which is too technical and complex to explain here. My analysis and conclusion are how liberty and security in my skating was won, and how it was challenged and for a time lost. I had to search internally for tried and true technique in mind, muscle, and neurological pathways. It is a metaphor about liberty in the United States. Slavka Cahoon taught skating, figure skating, for 70 years. She conveyed valuable tools of excellence directly and indirectly. The genius of Slavka Cahoon influenced my life in innumerable ways, which I use every single day. She patiently polished me a common pedal. Many others through my life were conveyors of and used tools of excellence. I will mention only a notable few. Mr. Walter Williamson, visionary owner of the wagon wheel. Helen Joanne Olson, my ballet teacher in Rockford. Nora Anderson, my sixth grade teacher. Ann Bill, my junior high school dean. Carl Nielsen, my high school counselor. My pastor, Elwood Peterson. Rudy Rufo, hairstylist extraordinaire, who created my hairstyle at age 16 that flew on ice and all over the world with me. And Adam Cromer, an Air Force Academy trainer, who was responsible for me recovering from a rare injury so I could defend my U.S. ladies' title in 1970. Barb Nelson voluntarily assisted my mother with scrapbooks and other related material. Carol Cotter and Alice Alfredson helped answer my mail after the 1972 Olympics, all 15,000 or so more letters, and became lifelong friends. I was blessed also to be the beneficiary of journalism excellence by respectful, honest, accurate, and insightful journalists in Rockford, specifically Rick Talley, Dave Schultz, and news photographer John Holt. And I am certain there were others. Journalistic excellence is a discipline to study. Conveyors of excellence and its tools, upheld by the spirit of liberty, can be searched for and found in the displays of Midway Village Museum in Illinois and in the United States of America. History matters. Tools of excellence can arise, be used and conveyed through the mind and actions and spirit of any person in any profession, job, study, or discipline in most any situation. It is a matter of using personal will and proper tools, including vision, action, logical individual thought, priorities, practice and repetition, humility, perseverance, endurance, and joy, with a noble goal of self-government, a principle of liberty. I am forever grateful that these quintessential gifts were conveyed and entrusted to me. It is my privilege to do my best to reflect and convey these gifts to you. Excellence pursued shines a thousand flashes of reflected light. Excellence is relevant. I conclude with an excellent verse to contemplate, written by a man named Isaiah. Quote, "And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. Thou shalt raise up foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in." End quote. Thank you so much for joining me in this exploration of conveyors and tools of excellence. I am so deeply honored to have had your kind and respectful attention. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much. We're going to do a Q&A now for a little bit of time. But first I want to read something from the city of Rockford. Mayor of Rockford is Thomas McNamara, whose father was mayor in the 80s, and he was the city attorney when you were competing internationally. So again, it comes full circle. So we got this proclamation from Thomas P. McNamara. "Whereas Janet Lindowicki started ice skating at a very early age in Evergreen Park, Illinois, and whereas in the early 1960s, Janet and her family moved to Rockford to be closer to the Wagon Wheel Figure Skating Club in Rockton, Illinois, where Janet trained with her coach, and whereas while living in Rockford, Janet attended Lincoln Junior High, and was just 14 years old when she competed in the 1968 Winter Olympics in Grenoble, France, placing ninth. And whereas Janet won her first senior title at the 1969 U.S. Figure Skating Championships, eventually winning the title four more times. Janet was a two-time World Championships medalist and won the bronze medal at the 1972 Olympic Games in Sapporo, Japan. And whereas through many years have passed, Rockford remains proud of Janet Lynn and her outstanding accomplishments, and considers her to be one of our city's greatest ambassadors. Now therefore, I, Thomas P. McNamara, as mayor of the city of Rockford, do hereby proclaim June 10th, 2020 to be Janet Lynn Day." I'm going to move this back a bit because we have our first question is an international question. After Matt Roberts wrote about Janet coming to Rockford, I got an email from a skating writer in Japan. And that's why I'm moving back, because they want to see her. They specifically wanted me to ask you about your enduring popularity in Japan. So my question, Did you at the time have any idea that simply smiling after falling would have such an effect on the people there? And are you surprised that all these years later, the popularity hasn't declined at all?
That's a long question to answer because there's a whole story behind it. And I don't think we have enough time to tell the whole story. I was completely surprised by the response of the Japanese people to me. I was, but just briefly, the story behind it was that when I competed in that final competition, I was pretty sure I could not win the gold medal. But at the Olympic Village, I was crying, that had been my goal, and praying. And I prayed and I asked God, why it turned out this way. And in my mind, something shifted during that prayer. And what shifted was, it no longer mattered if I won or even won a medal. The only thing that mattered to me at that point was to go and try to show God's love through that performance. And that was what was on my heart, in my spirit, when I stepped onto that ice. And so there was I've been back to Japan many times after that. Immediately after that performance, when I fell during that performance, it turns out that I smiled while I was sitting on the ice. And the Japanese press and the Japanese people could not understand why. And they started asking me then how I could do that. And it was because of how I had been trained, but also because of the purpose I had made for that performance. And I believe that it was during, I had been asked to be an ambassador 2 years before the Nagano Olympics, to be an ambassador for the Nagano Olympic Organizing Committee. And we were back in Japan, and they took me to Sapporo 2 years before to introduce the Nagano Olympics to the world. And they took, every time I went back to Sapporo, they took me to the Makamanai Ice Arena, even if it didn't have ice, and they made me sit down. And on this one occasion, they had media there to talk to me afterwards. And it occurred to me while I was there that the man that was interviewing me wasn't even born. And I asked him, and he was talking to me, and I asked him, I said, when, you know, how old are you? And it occurred to me that, I said, how do you know? How do you know what happened? And he goes, oh, everybody knows. Pass this on, generation. And I just literally started crying, and I couldn't finish the interview because I couldn't believe how God had answered my prayer, I guess, if it was a prayer, but I couldn't believe it. And they still asked me to that day, how could you keep smiling when you fell, when you had fallen in the Olympics? And I guess it's something that they are still asking. And that this past year was the 50th anniversary for the Sapporo Olympics, and they were having a big celebration, and they asked me if I would write something, which I did. And I was so very honored to be able to write that story for the Japanese people, which will now forever be in the museum of the Sapporo Olympics in Sapporo, Japan. And I received a beautiful, heartfelt letter from the mayor of Sapporo also, that we will always be bonded.
Aww. We had a several discussions on the phone with Janet before she came up here on what she wanted to talk about. One of the things we discussed one time was the relationship between the media today under like a 24/7 news cycle versus how she was. And she mentioned that Dave Schultz and Don Holt are here at her request. Mm-hmm. So, Janet, can you talk just for a couple minutes about your relationship with the local media and how you think that's maybe changed over time?
Not that extemporary. I did just prepare something about Dave and just a second. So I just wanted to during my tenure as a public figure in Rockford, nationally and internationally, many journalists interviewed me. And much was written about me and my figure skating. As I have looked through scrapbooks, often for the first time, I found the journalists in Rockford were both respectful and accurate when interviewing and writing about me. For this, I am deeply grateful. As a few Rockford journalists were superlative in their coverage of me from about age 14, onward. These are the late Rick Talley, Dave Schultz, and news photographer Don Holt. They always acted like gentlemen toward me. I am so pleased that both Dave Schultz and Don Holt are here today. And I'm so thankful to you. So, a couple of memories I have of Dave Schultz. I first met you, Dave, in 1969. And I had just won the US ladies title for the first time. And we were on our way to the North American Championships. And in my scrapbooks, I found a picture of you. This is the journalism of that era that I was exposed to by these great men. You were helping Slavka and I to pack the car. You were there helping us in any way that you could help us. And Don Holt, I remember, did a photography session with me on the pond outside of the wagon wheel on the golf course. There was a pond on the golf course of the wagon wheel right on the other side of the parking lot of the Ice Palace. And the paper wanted pictures, and he came out and I was freezing cold, and he had to be freezing cold. But he took beautiful pictures of me. And when I was at the Wheel Legacy of Excellence book, in one of the wagon wheel meetings that take place yearly at the Rockton Township Historical Society, Don came and presented me with that picture that he took on that day. And I believe he was also the one that when I got back from the Olympics in 1968, I was so exhausted. And I don't know who made this decision or how it all happened. And I now look at it very tenderly because Don was embarrassed almost to take the picture, but he actually came and took a picture of me sleeping with the permission of my parents. That was in the Rockford paper. But so respectful and so kind, apologizing. And another time, so Dave Schultz, the first year, I I was invited to do the International Skating Union tour after the World Championships in 1970. And it was my first year, that tour went to the USSR. And it was my first time in Moscow, in Kiev. And I came back from that trip. And I think I had a couple other things to do before I came home. But Dave was in the car, and I found the article the other day. Dave was in the car from O'Hare to Rockford in my parents' car as I was on my way home after 2 months away. And he was asking me questions or just listening. And he wrote in that article, and I said, and it was true, that the man on the plane on the way back from Moscow to New York, which was a Soviet plane, tried to make me a communist, but he did not succeed. Literally. And you wrote it. Thank you. Honest.
Okay, I've got two more questions. One's a personal one, and then one's more of your thoughts on skating in general. The personal one, we got a couple questions from the crowd. Where's Glenn? Right? So she had a very, her brothers and sisters are all athletic. Glenn Dulicki was on the state, the baseball team that finished second in state. Larry was an excellent athlete. We mentioned your sister was in gymnastics. So if you want to give the crowd kind of a rundown of where your brothers and sisters are right now.
My brother Larry was here. I don't know if he still is here. Maybe I bored him. Hi, Larry. My brother Larry lives in Wisconsin. My brother Glenn lives in California. And my sister lives in Washington State. And I just need to say, I found an article recently about, it was 1972, and my brother Glenn, I think Larry was at the Air Force Academy already, and Glenn had an opportunity to come to Sapporo to support me, which he always was supporting me. my family was always supporting me. And so, but he decided he couldn't leave his University of Missouri wrestling team as they were going to the championship, and he kind of needed to be a part of that. So he participated. He was an outstanding wrestler. And my brother Glenn is in the Hall of Fame for three sports at Guilford High School. And my brother Larry was actually the better athlete. just a really fun story is that this was the sense of humor that I grew up with in our family. So I got back from my brother Glenn had been at the wrestling tournament, and after he was done, he was out and he found a poster. And he brought the poster home and he put it in my room so when I got back with a bronze medal, it would be right over my bed. And I don't know if any of you remember back then, but there was two car rental companies, and one was, we're number two, we're number one, and the other was, we're number two, we try harder. Okay, there was two different, and so my brother found a poster, and he put it over my bed when I came home with the bronze medal, and it said, I'm number three, I don't try at all. I also remember Rick Talley writing about, after I competed my final in the Olympics in 1968 in Grenoble, France, and I Rick Talley then had called France to talk in my mom's hotel room, and I was there, and he wrote that I didn't want to talk about my skating, I wanted to know how my brother did in his wrestling tournament. That's the family support that we grew up with, and my sister was exceptionally talented in gymnastics as well, and she's phenomenal. She has 3 degrees from universities and a phenomenally talented individual. So we have a wonderful family, and I'm thankful for them.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to ask a short question about a skating figure, and then let's talk about ice skating for a bit, and then we'll transition. One is, so the wagon wheel drew lots of really good skaters. A lot of them came to train with Dan's coach. Interestingly, perhaps still the greatest male skater of all time, Scott Hamilton, trained briefly at the wagon wheel, went to Hanoniga High School. He's been up there a couple times, even though he didn't graduate from there. Specific question, do you get to hang out with Scott Hamilton much?
No.
Scott is a phenomenal person. He's very, very busy. He is a very inspiring person from everything that he's gone through in his life. And I, we have talked from very occasionally, but he is a phenomenal person, and I really, I look up to him, and I think very highly of everything he accomplished in skating, and also in everything he's overcome in life.
Okay, our last 3 questions are about figure skating, because it's a much different sport today than perhaps when you were competing. So one of the questions is about the outfits. They're very, very flashy today. Today there's no compulsory figures, and it's a very, very jump-oriented sport. So our question today is, what do you think of the direction of figure skating? Has it transitioned too much? What are your thoughts?
Do you have about 6 hours?
You choose unlimited.
Okay, so I'm going to just introduce this as before I answer this question. And this is a picture, you probably can't all see it, but nevertheless, this is a picture of me at age 11. And I had passed the highest figure skating test called the Gold Figure and Free Skating Test at age 11. And this is my grandfather standing with me. Aww. As I was given that award. I was, and I'm pretty sure this is correct, I was the youngest ever in the history of the United States figure skating to ever pass that test, the youngest. Wow. And I practiced figures from the time I was introduced to them by a teacher, Peter Dunfield, in Chicago before I ever came to Rockford, so probably when I was 4. I was introduced to skating on circles, and I actually have in my scrapbook, he asked his students to write what they learned. Well, I didn't know how to write yet, so I drew pictures. So I have that. I have those pictures that I drew, learning the figure eights and how he was the first to introduce me to that. But from the time I met Slavka, Miss Kahoot, and moved to Rockton at age 7 to skate more, and lived with my grandfather for about 6 months. I practiced figures 4 to 6 hours a day, 6 days a week, until the age of 19. And so I would like to kind of make a statement and correct the record of something that's been said for decades, that I didn't like figures is what has been said, and that's not true. Did I think they were going around in circles for 4 to 6 hours a day was more boring than jumping and spinning and doing all that? Yes, I thought that was more boring. But without the figures, and there were, maybe somebody in the room, skater, can remember how many figures there were, 60-something. There were over 60 varieties of figures that were done, and they were taught in a developmental system. Exactly the skills for the first test, you had to have those before you could go on, and actually the skills for the second test
built upon those skills. It was a developmental system that was exquisite, and I've searched and searched to find out who developed it. I don't know, but it was genius, how whoever developed it. Without those skills of balance and control, and I'll just, you know, explain a little bit here, and I don't know if anybody wants to stand up and try to do this, because I can't do it anymore, but if you consider that when we figure skate, because of the figures, okay, we had to glide on one foot on a thin blade with a slight lean on a circle because of the circular movement. You were on a slight lean and on an edge, so you couldn't be on the flat of the foot. You had to, in order to pass the test, you had to be a little bit tilted to the one side, so there was a clean line, one line, not two lines. If you were on the flat, there would be two lines on the ice. And so we had to glide, and not only glide, but then we had to like move our body, our legs, and we had to move our upper body, and we had to move our arms. And then there were three circles, and you had to turn, you had to do turns, front to back and back to front. And you had to change that edge at the very tip of the turn, and you could read it on the ice whether you did that or not. You could actually read the tracing on the ice as to whether you did it properly or not. And so, and then they had three circles, and you had to do a turn. It was, the first was just a change of edge. You would change from an outside to an inside edge without moving the outside of your body hardly at all. Like, how do you do that?
Yeah.
And if you are a figure skater, all of those intricacies, I mean, we had to literally go from the middle of our foot and rock to the ball of the foot at the right time on those turns, and then rock back down within a split second. We had to learn, and all of the muscles in the feet, and I've talked to my Slavka about this in not too long, you know, recent years anyway. And I said, well, it was the muscle and the muscle memory. And she said, no, Janet, it wasn't just muscle memory. She said it was neurological memory. And this is her biological background thinking, okay? She said it was neurological memory. And she said, muscle memory you can get pretty quickly, but you lose it more quickly. But neurological memory, which the figures taught us, and all of these intricacies that we did 4 to 6 hours a day, 6 days a week, I did, all of these intricacies gets into the neurological memory, and she said it's the neurological memory that you still remember. That lasts. The muscle memory can be lost quickly, more quickly, but the neurological memory lasts. And that's what all of these figures did. Now, there's a whole story behind this, and I don't know if you want to hear it all, but in 1971, at the World Championships in Lyon, France, well, first of all, I already said in my talk, in 1970, I won the figures at the Nationals. And after that, there has always been this narrative that I wasn't good at figures and didn't know how to do them and didn't like them. And it wasn't that I wasn't good at them, it's just that my competitors were more proficient than them. because I studied them a lot and I practiced them a lot. So in any case, in 1971, at the World Championships, I had come in fifth in the figures, but I had won the free skating. And that's what was seen on TV. And this was an embarrassment to me, and I've apologized to my competitors that were getting the medals, all of them. But while the ladies were getting them, I didn't even get a medal, but I won the free skating. And the ladies that were getting the medals, while they were getting them, the audience, the French audience, was chanting my name. And so I now know, because of an international judge that knew what happened, is that the French Federation was afraid that the French people were going to start some kind of a ruckus. And so I was pushed out while they were getting their medals to take it out. I was literally pushed out. It was that year that the International Skating Union decided at their yearly meeting that they would diminish figures. And so they would diminish, and in 1973, after the Olympics, they added skating to the short program, adding more to the free skating, and taking percentage away from the figures. Now, I have to say at this point, nobody ever asked me. I've still talked about it in relation to this. Literally in 1990, the figures were completely removed from the sport. The younger skaters don't even know very much that they ever existed. Okay? And this was the foundation of my skating. It was a foundation of everything I did. And again, it's a metaphor that I use having to do with our country. There's foundations. If you lose the foundations, you have something totally different than was originally intended. So nobody ever asked me my opinion about getting rid of figures in 1971 would have been what? 50-something years ago. Nobody ever asked me. And I completely disagree with that decision. And I think it was wrong, and I think it has increased injuries, because consider how strong the body would become if you were gliding on one foot or the other for 4 to 6 hours a day in the exact position you need to be in to take off from a jump and to land a jump in a way that is non-impactful. How strong would that make your body? It would make it very strong. And I was like, I was like a rock. Arms too, because your arms had to be out 4 to 6 hours a day. So I disagree with the decisions that were made. Nobody ever asked me. To this day, nobody's ever asked me. But you have. And I would like to see them return, because I think the skaters are being shortchanged, because they're losing out on an entire dictionary and language that would give so much more depth and opportunity. So.
All right, let's give everyone an applause. Jen has two more performances she wants me to play. And she did not pick the 1972 Olympics, she picked the 1968. When that's over, then everybody is going to please, who wants to stick around, we're going to have you move down the hallway to our Many Faces exhibit, which is our newest exhibit, and we're really proud of it. And you can wait there while Janet does about 20-25 minutes with local media, and then she's going to come in and talk some more with you. We have a stack of signed autographs that she wants to give out. She's never charged for autographs in her entire life. Another great thing about you. So, again, so we'll play the video and then we'll move everybody down the hall. Okay?
This video, I talked a lot about Afternoon at the Fawn, and this video is going to show Afternoon at the Fawn, the very first one, that's Slavka in 1968 at the Olympics, and my mother's pink dress with the pico hem. And the next video is going to be the last time I performed Afternoon of a Fawn as an exhibition number in 1982, and it was the last time I performed it, and it was the year before I completely retired.